Hello, willkommen and welcome to our TG webinar, where we would like to introduce our brand new product, Plant Optimization and Services. I'm very happy that you find the time to join us today. My name is Tobias Pucklewitz, and I'm the sales manager of TGE, and I'm happy to be your host and moderator today. We would have loved to present our company and our product face-to-face in an exhibition or on a conference environment, but unfortunately, we can only do it via the web in these times. This webinar will take about 45 minutes, where we will present to you our TGE company and product, and we will have then another 50 minutes for answering some questions. If you have any questions during our presentation, please do not hesitate to write them down in the chat function and we will answer them. Lucky for me, I am not alone during this webinar. I have my colleagues Markus and Julian with me. Markus is our Director Technical Sales and Julian is our Product Development Manager. Great that you're here with me and appreciate your time. Please introduce yourself.
Hello, everybody. Yes, thank you, Tobias. My name is Julian Tapitz. I'm a product development manager at TGE, working for more than 17 years already at TGE. And I'm always looking for best solutions for our customers.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Markus Ecker. I'm working with TGE. Not that long, just 16 years. And I'm extremely happy to have the chance today to introduce our new offering to the market and to you, esteemed customers.
We've thought about the best way to present our product and we've decided to do it within a discussion round. We hope technically wise, this can be successful and this webinar is streaming without any troubles or disruptions. Please let us know when you have any problems with your Steam. Before the start of our webinar, we have showed you a short company movie about our company TGE, what we are doing, where is our expertise, and how to use this expertise to support your projects, your products, and your developments. We have 40 years of experiences. We are one of the leading EPC contractors for handling and storage of liquefied gases. We have impressive reference over the years. We have all engineering know-how in-house, about 400 employees worldwide. We have two major operation units in Germany and China. As a short summary of our company, this is indeed impressive. Markus, maybe we can shortly explain and highlight the functions within a liquefied gas terminal, one of our main products.
Sure, Tobias, thank you. What we have here prepared is a nice artwork-like animation of a real existing project, which we have done recently in Antwerp, in Belgium. So you see here the main components of a typical liquefied gas terminal. So a large storage tank, in this case, 135,000 meter cube LPG storage, full containment steel concrete tank. On the top, we have all the facilities to pump in and pump out the product, all the safety related requirements are dealt with here on the tank platform. In front of the facility, you see here under this weather protection, under this shelter, the boil off gas compressors, which take care for the boil off, which has to be dealt with. And then a little bit further around the corner, also all installations that are needed to pump out the liquid LPG in this case to the river barges. It needs to be heated up. It needs to be conditioned to a certain extent. So therefore, we have these installations here. Also, as we are just flying over it, we have provided all the marine loading arms and river barge loading arms that will make it possible to break the bulk from the ocean-going gas carriers that arrive in Antwerp and then unload their cargo into the tank. And then from the tank again, the barges are loaded. And not to forget what was here in the scope is together with, let's say, the LPG-related process pipelines, the pipe racks, the safety installations, also all the utilities needed. So all the instrumentation, DCS system, the electrical switch gears, transformers, safety-related installations like an emergency diesel generator, fire water system, all that full scope has been part of this project. And yeah, it's quite interesting, quite challenging, but our more or less normal business to provide our customers the best total solution for such new build installations.
Thank you very much for this short summary, Markus. I think it's quite a massive thing what we need to take care about in this terminal, with all the different layouts and requirements we have to challenge in front of the clients here. Julian, coming to our new product, or better solution we are offering to our new clients here. Honestly speaking, this is really not new for us, right?
Indeed, Tobias. TGE has been involved during the recent years in some related projects already under the umbrella retrofit solutions.
And what is then really new for our clients?
Okay, what is really new is we have bundled now all our activities in this field to a new business unit plant optimization and services. This is to not just end at EPC, but also further care about our customers' needs during operation, the whole lifetime actually. And this we are now offering more actively with focused and bundled competences. As we can see, this becomes more and more now.
So you can say that the work is not new to us, but the priority within the group has been changed a little bit.
Oh, exactly, you can say like that. There are different things that are requested and that are part of it. We come to explain it more in detail, like plant lifetime assurance, product change, debottlenecking, capacity increase. Those kind of things have been requested in the past, and therefore, new business unit.
Maybe we just take the chance now to go into the business unit itself and also to highlight the products we are offering in this business unit.
Yes, as you can see here on this overview slide, we have now four groups forming part of this business unit. The first one is the so-called product change as part of plant conversion. I say already product change because it's a major motivation of doing so that we could see in the recent years. So assume a plant has been built for ethylene, for example, some time ago, and this is not the best business case for the customer anymore. He sees a new revenue stream, a new better business, which is more profitable. Customer may consider another product like propane, and then we have a look to it as part of this business line. Second one, as you can see, is so-called plant lifetime assurance. So there we look also during operation on the plant itself that everything goes wrong during operation, say with a 10 years contract, if this is needed, we fully care about maintenance for all the crucial plant systems. As you can see, our tank, or we have seen in Markus' video before, and the tank is the essential part of it. Certainly there we have particular expertise, but also related to all the cryogenic and applicable safety standards and regulations. We have bring our expertise and ensure that the plant will run reliably according regulations without interruptions. And that we are doing on the field with partners, similar to construction in the EPC project. We subcontract and work with partners, but all the planning, all the management, for example, also spare part management, we do fully in-house as part of this business line. Third one is the so-called energy and OPEX optimization. more or less self-explaining. We know energy emissions, all these things become more and more important. Certainly also in some aged facilities, they may have been built rather to optimize the investment cost, the CAPEX, not so much looking on the operational cost. So what we do here is to review what is possible to optimize energy and maintenance costs by new application of new processes, up-to-date equipment, and so on, so that we can really bring down the operational cost and also at the same time increase the and hold the reliability of the plant. And fourth part, last but not least, this is the so-called environmental impact optimization. Goes a bit in a similar direction, avoidance of too many emissions of CO2. We will have some examples today also to present what is possible here.
I think that's a very good takeover. Just to say, okay, we have examples here. We can show a little bit of details. I guess, Markus, we have something very interesting done as a project within the plant conversion.
Absolutely, Tobias. So we are quite happy that we have signed earlier this year a first contract in this new business unit. What you see here in front of you on the screen is a nice aerial picture of an existing LNG installation that has been built some 30, 40 years ago in the western part of the UK, close to a place called Avonmouth. It's not far away from Bristol. This asset has been operating as a peak shaving LNG storage for decades and has then been sold to our customer, to the company Flowgas Britain, because they found it quite interesting to generate new revenue streams out of this installation by converting it to LPG service. So our project now here comprises out of several different elements. So we will certainly convert the existing plant to cope with LPG instead of LNG. So there will be several parts that will be renovated. So we will have new in-tank pumps. We will have an update on the controls, on the safety systems, also on some safety installations like safety valves, etc. But also, quite interesting, there is a small or relatively small new build part in this project, which will serve as intermediate storage for the LPG, which is being received with road tankers. So LPG from road tankers coming from the refinery more south in the UK will arrive in Avonmouth, will be stored in the bullets, and then from the bullets it will be continuously go to the large atmospheric tank. And then the atmospheric tank will serve as a long-term buffer storage. And then whenever the peak demands are active, are required, Avonmouth facility will be in the position to send out and to load tankers very quickly, very flexible. So in principle, a very interesting project and fitting very well into our new business unit, which deals with conversion of existing assets.
As an EPC contractor, what were the real main challenges you had on this project?
Yes, certainly it is always an important point, first of all, to identify the technical requirements, the technical weaknesses, and also challenges. I think in this case, we have applied, let's call it success model, that we have used quite often in the past. So which means that we, with our very strong engineering colleagues, provided some consultancy work in the early stage, provided some engineering contracts, which helped the customer to shape and to define the project. So, and then with this well-defined project definition, project setup, which we performed in a small FEED study, we then went also into the EPC contract. Certainly, the EPC contract still has challenges. We will still have, from time to time, questions and discussions about the usual things, like, was this little pipe branch in our scope, or is there maybe a trench that has to be digged that has to come from somebody else? But these are the normal things. In general, here we have a very well-defined project, and we are now working hand in hand with our customer to make it reality.
But I can imagine that installations on a brownfield in a running operative plant, I guess another challenging part here is really the brownfield works, right?
Absolutely, that's a major challenge. Here we are in a very lucky situation that the existing facility is hydrocarbon free. But nevertheless, anyway, we have also experience in cases where it is not like this. So if we go now to the next slide, we see another recent project that we have just awarded. So here we have the Świnoujście expansion project in Poland. And also there, we will have the very challenging situation to integrate all the control system, all the power supply, the DCS, and everything with all the tie-ins into the running operation. And we will not be able to interrupt the natural gas supply to the grid even for half an hour. So what is a good part is that we have already this experience, as we have executed in the same way a project in Portugal some years ago. And now here with a very good and precise planning and good coordination with our customer and the operations, we are confident that we can execute this important step in a smooth way without major hiccups.
Excellent. I mean, I think what we also don't need to forget, Markus, are the startup conditions, no, in these plants. So if you integrate this plant, the new plant, so-called new plant in the brownfield, in the existing plant, I think that also needs a lot of experiences, right?
Yes. I mean, when we go to the example of our Polish project, luckily, in the first phase, in the original design, there were already expansion connections foreseen. Very challenging things like hot tapping into the existing plant are not needed. We just have to properly connect to the foreseen extensions. But in the control system, this we have experienced in the past, there's a major challenge to switch on all the controls, all the electrical consumers without interrupting the normal operations, without provoking, for instance, an emergency shutdown of the operating terminal. So that's something that with very detailed and very good planning can be done.
Thanks, Markus. I think that gives us a very good or high overview what plant conversion really means in these days, especially in the brownfield, under brownfield conditions. Let's go to the next subject. Julian, under plant lifetime assurance and maintenance, I can first imagine tank inspections. Why is this an option and why is it so important?
Yeah, okay. Once more, the tank is clearly the key equipment in such an installation, the key asset. There's most of the financial investment behind. Although the tank is constructed and designed in a very robust manner, certainly, usually you do not have spare capacity as it is common, for example, for rotating equipment. So it is of utmost importance that this key equipment is in a very good shape, very safe shape, and does not need interruptions, shutdowns, for example. So, okay, I can furthermore add that certainly in case something went not ideal during operation with the tank, it could have very expensive consequences. Imagine there is a damage somewhere that causes consequential damages. And in the worst case, it could even create hazardous scenarios or do not talk about catastrophic events. So therefore, it is very important to keep the overall facility, particular from the safety point of view, always in a very, very safe and controllable situation.
Do you have maybe some examples for such kind of hazardous events?
Yes, not from TGE plants, fortunately, but here and there we do have some pictures and videos. Unfortunately, we cannot show everything due to confidential information also, but here you can see two videos. The first one shows you a leaking flange that can happen due to the shrinking of piping systems. Yes, as we are talking about usually cryogenic liquids, it's very important to have the piping system completely correctly designed, but also constructed. Construction supervision is important, also maintained during operation. Here in the second video, you see even a leaking tank. So this should not happen, very clear. This type of tank, this is a steel concrete tank, has or should have an internal liner, avoiding that any product vapor will leave the tank through the concrete, since the concrete is not tight as such, but also the other way around, no air humidity, oxygen, or water vapor will enter the tank from external. So it means that in this video, very probably the inner liner has a defect. Due to any reason, the defect or the mistake can happen through the whole life cycle of such an installation. It might be that the design has been insufficient already. It might be that the material supply during construction did not meet the quality requirements. Certainly also construction is an issue if weldings or construction tolerances haven't been sufficiently responded and complied with, then there may certainly result such a scenario. And it can also happen during operation. Imagine abnormal operation scenarios that certainly should not happen, like too many thermal cycles. Normally, this should not happen. Overpressure. This is something that can create problems. And by doing tank inspections on a regular basis, we will look on all the potential issues and can react a time already before something worse will happen.
I guess generally you can say that quality and safety issues can start any time of the plant life cycle, right? So it's could be starting from the engineering, can go through construction issues to the commissioning, maybe wrong commissioning procedure, and then you go into the operations, which can be then, of course, any kind of mistakes in the operations itself or some fatigue over the time can delay or can happen to any kind of disruptions here. But especially for these tank inspections or for inspections anyway, Can you do this during the terminal operation, or do we need a shutdown for this?
Yeah, this is a good question. There are indeed two possibilities. One is the so-called in-service inspection, and the other is the so-called out-of-service inspection. The in-service inspection does not require any plant shutdown, interruption, and even brings advantages because you can detect and see things that you would not see so easy by taking the tank out of service. And one example would be, as you can see here on this slide, a problem that is often, more frequent occur than someone may think, is a problem with the insulation. In many facilities, aged facilities, either the insulation has not been sufficiently designed in regard to the environmental weather conditions. You see here a picture in the bottom left corner where there should be outer insulation, but it's not there anymore. So this happens from time to time again. Then in the upper left corner, this is a typical problem with the perlite insulation and settlement over time. And then the upper right one shows the picture where you also very probably have a problem with the insulation, but even it's also showing a problem with the liner. This occurs rather in context with polyurethane insulation. And in the bottom right corner, you see a possibility how to measure temperatures by doing thermal scans. So all these things are part of an in-service inspection that you can see during operation, also gas leakage and process data in the DCS will be reviewed if these behave in a planned or in a dedicated way or not. So in the second one, out of service inspection indeed require a full decommissioning of the facility, and then you can enter the tank. You can have a look on weldings, on the material. Okay, corrosion should normally not happen since there should normally no presence of oxygen, for example. But you can do NDTs like ultrasonic, like X-ray to check all the material, and can do certainly also repair. Or you see that some freezing may have happened, that water was inside the tank due to any reason, and you can further investigate. So those things you can see only by taking the tank out of service.
And we are capable to do these inspections by ourselves?
Yes, all. And what helps is certainly the long-term EPC experience through the whole EPC phases from engineering to construction and commissioning. But in addition, we do also have internal tank assessors according the EMUR 159. And this is something that needs to be refreshed every 5 years, but brings our tank assessors into the position to do full assessment and provide a solution for a repair. Okay, we have not only the look on the tank itself, but also on the all-over facility, like special compressors that you need, special pumps. And there we have also from our EPC experience bring the required knowledge and know where the critical details are, because always, or we could see always the technical details are the important at the end and the decide and if the plant can be continuously operated or not.
Okay. I think that was a good hint, Julian, because now we come to the process equipment. And I think the next subject is a very important part in this. Here we talk about energy efficiency and optimization. And that's somehow a crucial and important subject everywhere where you go in every business unit right now. What are the crucial subjects for our business here?
Yeah, okay. Safety and OPEX are during operation of utmost importance for our customers, that we can see. Yeah, on this slide, there is an example. Usually, when TGE offers a new plant to the customer, TGE looks already very early to offer options regarding a favorable operational cost. So in case there's something requested by the customer, but we find something which is might be better in terms of operation, we will offer this and discuss with the customer if this isn't better for a better solution for, to better meet his requirements. But nevertheless, as said before, there are meanwhile many operations in the world, many plant facilities and operations in the world, aged already from maybe from the middle of the last century, even 50 years old somewhere and older. And this means that the processes are not up to date, the equipment is not up to date. And here is an example. What we have done in somewhere in the recent years in China, we built there also an ethylene terminal as part of the PVC plant, production plant, that also requires chlorine. The scope of TGE has been a new build plant, but nevertheless, what you see on the picture is a heat integration module that can be easily also applied for existing installations. I would like to give you a very quick idea what the cost savings are here for that plant. In that facilities, you needed about 40 tons per hour chlorine, as you can see here in the bottom right corner, and 27 tons per hour ethylene in that process. And the idea here is, and this is shown in the PINID, to have a heat integration and heat exchanger that via an intermedium brings the products together, exchange the heat. That means the ethylene will be vaporized by provision of heat from chlorine, and the other way around, the chlorine will be condensed by getting the cold from the vaporizing ethylene. And in this calculation example, we can save almost continuously 1.5 megawatt electrical energy for driving a liquefaction or condensing unit for chlorine, mm-hmm. which is, so just by providing the ethylene cold, and that could save about 12,900 megawatt hours per year, and assuming a electrical tariff of 10 US dollar cent per kilowatt hour, you would save about 1.3 million US dollar per year operational costs. This is very interesting. But on the other hand, also CO2 emissions become more and more a subject, we know, and even fees and taxes might be charged in the future that will even increase those costs. And so, in this example, it was assumed that we take the electrical energy from coal process, meanwhile, we know we have more renewable energy in the world. Nevertheless, still a lot of installations run in regions where electrical energy is produced from coal. Therefore, in this example, the CO2 emission calculation.
So you create real value for the client here. And what do you think? Where are the costs for these kind of object? Because that is, of course, if you say this, you can save this and that. But now we need to talk about the costs for such a
Yeah. We know costs are always a bit also project specific. You cannot I cannot communicate no number. This is a fixed price for it. Unfortunately, this is not possible. It depends on an EPC on many factors still, particular in a retrofitting project. It depends on distances, on integration, on labor costs, and so on and so on. But nevertheless, we would think that such an installation, conservatively calculated, would back in a period of 4 to 5 years.
Very good. When I see chlorine, ethylene, very cold, I have some safety constraints a little bit. I don't know, Markus, can you tell me a bit about the safety constraints of this unit?
Yes, Tobias. I think everybody or many people in our industry are talking a lot about heat integration, or it's especially the use of the cold stored in the liquid gas. Here, this example is one where we put it into reality already some years ago. And we are not doing this very easy and very simple. So we have applied all required safety reviews, all required HAZOP and other studies. And we developed a very safe system and setup for this heat exchange, because as you rightly indicated, Tobias, the two fluids, ethylene and chlorine, they even are interested to react with each other. Also the hazard for human beings and for the environment is quite big when talking about chlorine. It's very corrosive and toxic. So we went here through a detailed study and analysis and came up with a design which we believe is quite safe, because the heat exchanger provides some special features, like that the heat exchange is happening via an intermedium liquid or fluid in this case, which also lowers the risk of direct contact of the two liquid gases in question, and therefore also here operational risks are quite reduced.
Very good. So we can be comfortable that everything will be safe for the clients.
Julian. Under normal circumstances, the plant is very safe. You see on the picture, just to say a few sentences to that, the yellow line coming into the lower bundle, that's the gas, the gaseous chlorine line. And then at the bottom, the liquid comes out. And on the top, it's the same for the ethylene. So liquid ethylene comes in, is being vaporized at the upper bundle, and the heat exchange in between is happening with the intermediate liquid, which is also inert for reactions. It's already saturated fluorochlor hydrocarbon, so it cannot react anymore, so it's quite safe.
Very good. Thank you, Markus. I think what we need to find for energy efficiency, I think we have another example ready. And I know that Julian is very keen to introduce this because it is a little bit his baby. Julian, I know we have another practical example for energy efficiency, and I know that is your baby. So please tell us a bit more about in-tank pumps.
Yes, okay, Toby. It's not really my baby only, but I find it indeed as a very important contribution or development from the recent years. We are talking about the in-tank pump. I call it as the heart of our plant. It pumps the product continuously. So it's of utmost importance that this equipment is reliable. And there are possibilities to maintain the pump during operation. This is possible. You can see it in a movie here. This movie shows the lifting during construction phase, so without product, but in principle, the same can be done during operation, certainly without a person at the bottom. But nevertheless, the best is that the pump does not need so much maintenance. And where does it come from? We have seen in the recent years quite often, also in our plants, but also in other plants, that pumps get a problem after 2-3 years operation. The pumps usually, though the existing pumps, make use of roller bearings. And in the previous slide here, we have some two pictures that show consequential damages from broken bearings, or okay, it can also come from icing. This is a broken inducer or a broken impeller, for example, but any part in inside the pump can get a damage. And the much better design is the magnetic bearing, the touchless bearing, what we know from external pumps for a long time record already, where we do have long-term experience, and those kind of pumps, they just run for 10, 20 years without any interruption. So this is a big, big advantage compared to the conventional solution of roller bearings that we can exclusively offer to our customers as part of a new plant, certainly also revamp, retrofit. It's easily done during operation. You get a much more reliable equipment that quickly pays back if you do not need plant interruption. And at the same time, you can imagine this touchless bearing also provides advantages in terms of energy consumption, in terms of possibilities to operate it with a frequency draw. So there are many further advantages with such a kind of pumps, but the main one will definitely be, I see, the avoidance of interruptions, maintenance, therefore very highly reliable sent out of the product.
So it means that this is really a special designed product which we can offer to our clients?
Correct. Quite new. We have now our first project started that design. Mm-hmm. And we are very confident and looking forward to offer those things now to many customers, where we are absolutely convinced that this is the right direction for the customer, the big customer value for operations.
I can imagine that. Thank you, Julian. Mm-hmm. Another not less important subject here is, of course, the energy. Next to the energy optimization is, of course, our environment. Environmental impact is a key decision for all the operators and will be reviewed anytime critically. Where do you see the chance to support the environment within our offered products to our clients?
Yeah, Tobias, actually, our installations are normally, we can say, zero emission installations. So once in operation, with all the installations, the boil-off gas treatment, the safety installations, there will be only really occasional events where you have to flare or where you have to vent hydrocarbons to the flare, or even in the ultimate scenario to the atmosphere from the tank top. However, when bringing such an installation into operation, there is a certain phase in the commissioning where it is inevitable to flare or to vent vapors to the environment. And that's in the commissioning, because as you can imagine, after the construction is finished, the mechanical completion has been done, then the people, the workers, will ultimately evacuate the tank. The tank will be boxed up, closed, and then the breathing atmosphere, the oxygen, will be purged out. This is done first with nitrogen, large amounts of nitrogen, which is not an issue. But then certainly later on, you also have to introduce the later product, the product vapors, be it natural gas or be it LPG or even such very precious and expensive natural liquid gases like liquid ethylene. So for that reason, we have developed a small portable unit, a skid-mounted unit, which can be easily connected to the related pipework, the main flare header pipework. Then we will use a refrigerant which is available all over the world to then do a condensation of this mixture that will occur during the process of purging the tank from nitrogen to the product. This process has been developed in collaboration with the university during a master thesis of a student. And we are also quite happy that this student is now, since some years, working with us, very successful as a process engineer, and that we could apply this interesting development even to the schools and to the universities. Just a little bit how it works and why to apply. There is a case which we have taken as a basis. So there is, for instance, a 50,000 meter cube ethylene tank, which has to be cooled down. And before we can do that, as I mentioned, we need to exchange the nitrogen. So if we do it in a well-controlled and very good way, as we normally can achieve, then the volume of the tank has to be exchanged roughly 1.2 to 2 times sometimes. So, which means for such a tank with just 50,000 cubic meters, 170 tons of ethylene have to be flared, have to be used as a purge gas. So with a market price, and ethylene is, one of the most expensive products, of 920 euro per ton, we talk about easily a waste of 156,000 euros. So and as the product is ultimately flared and burned in a flare, so also there is a CO2 emission of roughly 5,500 tons. So this is a quite a saving because we can avoid to generate this large flow going to the flare. Actually, this unit, as it is mobile and can be dispatched to all different project sites, can be also used at jetty head installations when gas carriers have to undergo also a product change. We know it's still common practice and still done in some places that the product change of the gas carriers is done outside on the open sea, in the open water, that then with their own nitrogen generation, they will purge the tanks. And then they will have some small deck tanks with the new product to gas up the tanks with the new product. However, restrictions and also environmental awareness is luckily increasing. So these activities will be done under more environmental friendly circumstances, and with this system, we have a very good means to avoid these emissions.
Thank you very much, Markus. Very impressive. And I guess a very good way for our clients to save the money here. So in general, I think we have finished now the introduction of our new product line. We've talked about process equipment. We have talked about the storage tank itself, as we see it as the main equipment within our terminals. Maybe just to highlight that again, these tank solutions. We have on the one side these atmospheric cryogenic refrigerated storage conditions where we have our flat bottom tank technology. And on the other side, we have our pressurized storage conditions where we talk about spherical tanks, where we talk about horizontal bullets, where we talk about vertical bullet tanks, where we talk also about the possibility to put earth cover tanks in it. So all this kind of together gives quite a huge amount of experiences in tank solutions for all kind of liquefied gases. And this brings us into the role of an EPC contractor with a lot of experiences, with a lot of very good and professional solutions for our client. And I hope this will also bring our client a lot of support for their handling and storage terminals. They are planning to do so. Okay, I think we are finished from our side so far. That all give us a good impression where we are standing, what our goal is here, and what is our aim with our product, and where our expertise is. We could have also gone into much more details, of course, but our time is also somehow limited. We don't want to get you too long in front of the computer or wherever you're watching us. So I would like to take the opportunity now to ask for some questions, if they have any questions, or maybe we can already check if there are the questions which we can answer now. I see in the live stream now a few questions popping up. Very good for us. Thomas, first of all, thank you for your statement. It's good that we take care about the environment. Very true. I think as an EPC contractor, you have some kind of task worldwide to take care about the environment. And I think it's a very high subject for us. Environment, health and safety are one of the major issues we have. Peter, what can be the consequences if not directly shut down? I think this popped up during inspections, Julian. Can you give us a bit more information about this one?
Okay. This depends indeed where the leakage is occurs. Is it here from the piping system or in the storage tank? In any case, what we have seen here in the videos beforehand, immediate action will be required. This means, shutdown, emergency shutdown, even if it happens during operation, will be required, and a serious search what went wrong. Because the tank, for example, the cause for the leakage may be one that can become worse if not immediately taken action. So imagine there is an inner tank failure, inner tank problem that gets worse. That could come a much, much more serious scenario. Mm.
Okay. Another question here is about the insulation. How can it be repaired and how long would be the shutdown for this?
I assume this is also related now to the storage tank insulation, and there we have different types of insulation. It depends if you talk about bottom insulation, wall insulation. I have not yet addressed, we have also a suspended deck inside the tank, often done and insulated with mineral wool. So there are different types of insulation, and what we had seen in the picture with the icing on the outer tank wall, typical for a perlite tank after several years of operation, you see in the bottom a wet ring. This yeah. comes from settlement of insulation of the perlite insulation. This can be indeed repaired and solved during operation. So there we have possibilities to do that. We have done that. No problem. If you look on other insulation systems in the annular space, like the polyurethane insulation with this vertical shape of icing, then you need to enter the tank. You need to take the tank out of service. On the other hand, you would not have this settlement problem with polyurethane. That means once this system operates stable after commissioning, usually we would not expect problems here. So it depends pretty much on the location of insulation system, but also for suspended deck inside the tank bottom, certainly you need to enter the tank.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I hope that is answering these questions about the tank inspections. The other famous question, of course, is always hydrogen. We know that that's a lot of people are asking us right now, what kind of hydrogen solutions do you have? Do you have already, I don't know, the need for hydrogen in these kind of enormous amounts, which we can maybe store in our atmospheric storage tanks? Julian, any ideas about product change to hydrogen in our plant conversion model?
Okay, it's looking into the future. It's a good question because now also we look during our new offering for new terminals to consider a multi-product storage already, so that there's maximum flexibility for the future for the customer. You can imagine LNG infrastructure that might be changed in the future to hydrogen. I absolutely agree with you, Tobias. At the moment, the market is not there. I would see the need first for a lot of power to X to produce the amount of hydrogen that we can store in our storage tank. as part of the all of our supply chain. But technically, yes, will be possible and depends a bit on the storage type. Is it cryogenic storage? It will be very low temperature. We need to take care about this storage temperature, design temperature, but also the construction methods.
What is it? Minus 250 degrees, right?
Something like that. Yeah. I don't have the exact number now in my mind, but somewhere there. Exactly. Yeah. And on the other hand, the CO2 carbon capture and storage is also a big discussion point at the moment. And there I see it much more realistic to do a retrofit in the future, whereas this is rather applicable and possible for pressurized storage because of the thermodynamic properties of CO2, which are special. You need to have more than five, six bars, so that it can be liquid. But this is something I see it very soon. So if someone has somewhere a pressurized storage and does not know exactly what he can do with it, and it is coincidentally at a strategically interesting location, it could serve as a hub and as part of an infrastructure of CCS.
Okay. Maybe quickly, because we just got a few more questions and I think we are running nearly out of time. Markus, the services we are providing, are they coming out of Bonn? Are they coming from other branches?
Okay, Julian. Sorry, Tobias. We have here in the company, in the headquarter, certainly the main people that will do the services, that will that have also the related qualification and certificates. But certainly for the, let's call it blue-collar labor, we will partner up with local companies that are at the place of the project site. So that's also very clear. Yes, and certainly the coordination will be done via the head office here, and we are happy to receive your inquiries and further questions via the internet links that are also attached to this presentation.
Okay, very good. And I guess there's a special question for the hydrocarbon recovery unit, which you can maybe answer as well. How long is the delivery time for this one?
Okay, this depends a little bit for what application it will be required. But from the mechanical equipment which is inside this unit, we can assume that the delivery time will be in the range of 9 to 10 months. And then you have to add the shipping time needed to get it to the project site.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very good. I think, yeah, job positions. For job positions, you can always go on our internet page. We have also an HR human resources link there with new job positions, and have a good word with Markus, because as our head of department, he will take care about the right positions at right places. I guess that's it. Guys, thank you very much for joining this webinar. First of all, our audience, I wish everyone, of course, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. Use the free times for your to see your family and have a good time. Oh, Markus is already dressed up like Santa Claus. So maybe some words from you guys before we leave.
Oh, it was a great pleasure. Thank you very much and Happy New Year and happy holidays. Merry Christmas.
Julian?
Also from my side, thank you very much for your time, for listening. Please contact me, contact us. And I also wish you all the best for Christmas, and hopefully here's a lockdown since yesterday in Germany, so hopefully it's soon over and we can come all back to normal. All the best for you.
Thank you so much. Okay, everybody, stay healthy, have a good time, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year from all of us in TGE, and if you need any kind of services, let us know. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.